Was that banned last game?
It was banned.
It was banned. Okay. So I'm curious to see how this one goes. We definitely know Pilot Eye is a big IO player.
They ban Wyvern.
Both of the first phase heroes that OG just ran.
Okay, this has to be too good, right, for OG. It has to be too. They have to go for the IO.
I don't know.
But if they don't, Cloud9 will. That's where I'm seeing the issue arise.
Yeah.
Because then you give Cloud9 the ability to actually pick their combination. And it's going to be a Phoenix. Well, we talked about Icebird versus Firebird. Firebird was the big thing from Fly at TI6.
Yep.
Now TI7, he's going to bring it back.
Hero is pretty good against IO. They're considering that Cloud9 will go that route. Phoenix has pretty good solutions. Hard for IO to use the tether heal when he's under the effects of any of the damage over time abilities Phoenix has plenty of. It's very difficult to model. Cloud9.
Well, ice and fire. It's not the sisters combination. Instead, it's the sister and the very weird dead uncle.
Yeah. I don't even know where to go with that. Okay. So anyway, the Lina pick is surprising to me. I don't think Lina generally gets picked this early. I said that about Wyvern in the last. Seeing some shifts here. Lina is, however, decent against Phoenix, has good burst to kill Phoenix off if it's caught off guard by a stun, can destroy the supernova fairly easily with the stacks of Fiery Soul. And they go for the Lich again, which we haven't really seen, we didn't see in the last series. I don't know how much this hero has been favored in other matches today, but Cloud9 have first faced it twice now, so this might be a Cloud9 thing.
Invoker pickup, so Masters of Fire, of course Invoker does have some other talents as well. But I'm actually thinking about that Lina as well, because I was one team I was doing my research on, and I'm fairly certain it was Cloud9 where AUI was, but I didn't write it down in my book of things.
It could very well be. He has played some more uncharacteristic supports in the past, where he, one of AUI's strengths as a support player is he's very good at the farming style. So if you play like that, if you have a dynamic in your team where one support gets to farm quite a lot, that he is the type of support player that can make a Lina work very well. There's other players that it wouldn't be that good of a fit for. For example, Pilot Eye, doesn't really fit his archetype of his style of play as a support player. I could see it being an option for AUI. I think if you're running support Lina, however, you want your carry or your core mid, like one of the cores should set up your stun, because it's not reliable. It's generally the other way around you play, that the support set up the cores to shine, but you can actually set up a position for it to shine if you have the right ways that the heroes play off each other. Hero like Chaos Knight, for example, is very strong as a carry together with support Lina. Very high kill potential together, both in lane and in the mid game.
Speaking of CK, he was banned in the second phase of the last game. So
by Cloud9.
Should look to see if they do it again. We've already taken out the Phantom Lancer, so they're very much forcing OG to play a different style, and now they will ban the Chaos Knight.
It means TA is available again. But they already grabbed Invoker, so that's why they don't care, actually. So never mind about that.
Yeah, and up against a Phoenix, she'll burn to death.
Yeah. Let's see. So, OG, what did they ban apart from AM last game? It was AM and another carry, I think.
The ability to actually tab that and look for... you can look up the drafts, man.
All right. All right.
Stop being lazy over in that corner.
All right.
You just click on the right.
Casting.
Okay. Let me call out the play. 1 minute, 29, 28, 27, 26.
Okay, so last game, OG banned Alchemist. Alchemist, that's
Alchemist,
what it was.
Second phase.
So Alc got through this time. They banned the Batrider instead. There's a lot of adaptation compared to last game. There's so many bans that were present in last game. Bat is out. Wyvern, and Nyx, and PL. So we have four of the previous heroes banned in 8 bans. It's pretty common to see one or two sometimes that you just shift it up a bit, but this is a big change up the second game.
Envy's playing the long game. Playing for the 18th ball. He understands that he needs to see OG strategies, more of them, So just keep banning out the heroes they played before and force Ochi to pick something new and different. And hello, Earth Spirit. He was banned out in the first phase previously. It was done by Cloud9, I believe, in the first phase of last game.
Who placed this hero on Cloud9?
That
doesn't really strike me as an AUI hero, but it is a 4. This hero is not really a 5.
Paladai will play the Lich.
So it... Yeah, I mean, I guess there's no choice.
Yeah.
This is a bit surprising to me. I didn't think we were going to see AUI playing in Earth Spirit, but looking forward to it. That also means the Lich is a core. Unless this is... It is possible to play Earth Spirit offlane. You can put it there. And in some games, it can actually shine from that position because you get faster levels, and this hero scales incredibly well with levels.
I'd be very concerned that you wouldn't really have a tanky frontliner if you did that, especially now as Juggernaut.
Yeah.
Once again, getting worked into that one position.
Probably just a standard Lina mid, Earth Spirit support, Lich support, and then the Earth Spirit will focus a lot on mid. I guess they're picking the Earth Spirit mainly because of Invoker. It's actually a very good counter because Invoker is one of those mid heroes that's very static, very immobile, and can be put under a lot of pressure. And then you have this kind of a high impact lane, like a kill lane. Earth Spirit Lina can cause a lot of trouble. So see where they're coming from here with these two picks together. Just see what they decide to go for their off lane now. Juggernaut will safe lane carry. I like the Jugger pick more in this game, by the way. I want to point that out. I think it makes a lot more sense to me to pick this hero against Phoenix and Invoker. Invoker 100% spell based. Jugger is a great hero against Phoenix. Healing Ward messes with Sunray. You have a hero who can actually spin and destroy the egg. Pretty good choice overall. And I like it with like the pacing of Cloud9's lineup in this game. It's fast again. See if they can get better results out of it this time.
They just need the aggression to come with it.
Yes.
Like if they hold back and they farm, then you're going to see what we've seen from Anub time and time again. We saw it with the Templar Assassin. Early game doesn't go well. Players catch up with Ancients. Invoker, early game goes half decently. Picks up Midas and mid game goes really well. T-Rex will play very problematic for the mid. So maybe that's the other question mark too. How hard can that Earth Spirit rotate? We talk about Cloud9 not having that very obvious Earth Spirit player. It's not as obvious as someone like Jirax from OG, who is just renowned for that player.
Yeah.
Cloud9 doesn't have that type of player on the ES. And then you're going up against renowned Earth Spirit player. Jirax is going to know when that gank's going to be coming in. And we get an Axe pickup now from S4. This is very, very tanky lineup and survivable lineup once more from OG.
Axe is a bit hit or miss against this type of lineup, though. He's very good against Juggernaut, but that's it. I don't think he's good against any of the other heroes. And OG are running out of time, and they're probably just like, okay, how do we get a hero that can deal with Jugger? Because the rest of our lineup is not good at dealing with Jugger this time. Axe gets Blink Blade Mail, Jugger kills himself on the Blade Mail. It's a pretty standard counter. The problem is Axe is not good against this like magic burst early game.
Yep.
See, sure, you've got Berserker's Call to stay alive against the physical, but you're actually just going to die to these heroes in lane. Juggernaut isn't even a particularly good matchup in lane if there is stuns to set him up for the spin. So
they still banned the Void. Like, I know the Void could work for No-Tail in the safe lane.
I think it's a good ban. I think it's a very good ban, actually.
There goes the Enigma for Cloud9. Actually, yeah, it would have been that big AoE control they're still looking for, and they needed something out of their safe lane.
Yeah, I think they wanted Void, actually. Agree with that ban 100%. Sets up Invoker and Phoenix very well. It's very classic OG pick together with Phoenix. It doesn't have the best synergy with Axe though, but I think they could have still taken that route, especially when they're this short on time and they're like, okay, we need to make a decision. Fall back to your comfort zone.
Time is terrible. They've only got 5 seconds to make their choice, and Fly does not look confident. He says,
Yeah.
Well, I suppose it's one way to stop Omnislash from killing you, because it's going to cause problems against Lina.
I love this hero. I love this hero, and I think it's good sometimes, and I think this is one of those games where it can work. So if you play Pugna position 1, which it looks like they will, they'll put the Invoker mid, you need a hero that can deal the physical damage that Pugna can't, and Invoker is one of those hybrids that has the damage in him if it's needed on Exort build to actually be able to right-click heroes. Nether Ward is fantastic this game. It's very good against Lina and Lich. Like you said, the Crepify has plays against Juggernaut, and
I don't think they've got the counter push against him either.
Like, not really.
Like, you've got ability to clear wave, but the Crepify doesn't really care. Lich and Earth Spirit are not the greatest heroes for pulling wave. In fact, that's actually been one of the big things people have pointed out about Lich, the fact that he drags the creep wave back onto his tower. there's less defense when he sacrifices.
Yep.
So maybe that's when Pugnot turns this into a push game.
Now, the downside for OG is that both of their cores are fragile, low HP end heroes.
Yeah.
And Cloud9 can try to abuse that with the right offlane pick. I'm trying to think of what is available to them. So Nyx would have been fantastic. Antimage as a carry would have been fantastic, but he's banned and they have Jugger. But there has to be something in the pool here for them that really deals with these int heroes well in the offlane. I don't think Nyx is the only choice. There's plenty of heroes that can like just burst and kill them off. I was thinking Puck could be a choice. Actually sets up and rounds up their lineup very nicely, but he's not the best against Pugna. Timbersaw! Okay. So I think instead we're going to see the approach here from Cloud9 that they're trying to enforce a Timber versus Axe matchup. And then they will do something pseudo aggro again. Maybe the Lich Jugger. Love, by the way, how there's two of every hero. Is that just on my screen?
It's just on your screen.
Oh, I have two of every hero.
You're right, they're warping in and out.
Models are like on top of each other. Okay. Timber versus Axe matchup is... Actually, if it's one-on-one in isolation, it's a pretty even matchup in the beginning, but then Timber generally takes over, unless Axe gets very good spins in the start. And then the other lanes, we will see that Lich Jugger could go aggro again. I think it's totally playable, this game especially. And then they can target the Invoker really hard because their safe lane is freed up. If Earth Spirit and Lich can both leave the safe lane alone, they can shut down Ana a lot harder than in last game. And Invoker, yes, he can come back like TA can, but it's a different curve. It's not like that. You just farm two stacks of triple Ancients and you're back in the game. If Invoker is destroyed in lane and gets a couple of deaths, it takes longer.
Yeah.
And OG's lineup doesn't seem like the best to like make the space for him to come back. But we'll see how it goes down. I really like this draft. To me, this is a very unpredictable game with a lot of like X factors. Mainly, I think heroes to watch out for will be Earth Spirit. And two, will he get to play Dota? The other one, like, is he actually? If Axe has a miserable lane, if he has a very, very hard time, it takes so long to come back. Sometimes. Sometimes you miss the timing window of the hero that he's looking for. A lot of it comes down to whether they get the lanes they want. So let's see. Maybe they even put the Timber off lane at the bay for him. Try lane the Axe for that reason, that they want Axe to be shut down really hard. Who knows?
Well, early vision up. We'll see where everyone's going to go. So it is going to be No-Tail into the safe lane. Flies hovering around mid with just Obs and Sentry, but you also notice the aggressive wards out from Cloud9. They smoked, they got out early. OG have no idea about this, so they're watching the ward, the rune, the bounty rune up on the top, keeping that eyes very closely on that, and then the other one's into mid. So they're wanting to focus on the rotations off the top lane from OG, as well as give any kind of advantage into the mid lane that allows Farda to win that. And OG's vision is also more towards the bottom lane rotation. They haven't put down their second obs just yet, so we'll have to keep an eye on Fly to see where he believes.
Yep. I love this Phoenix.
What's he got on?
Vermilion Crucible. It sure ain't no shovel and triangle head, that's for sure.
It was an awe. It was an awe.
I keep telling yourself that.
I actually asked a bigger question. Why does an egg have a model which looks more like a bear? When you click on the item they actually have, it looks more...
How does that look like a bear?
That was a bear. Look, right there, the model modifier, it's a bear.
Oh, I see, okay.
Yeah.
You meant the model itself looked like a bear. I was like, how do you see a bear in this lava egg? All right, let's look toward mid, Toby. Dota's happening, and they want to try lane Fata in the start. Shards. Jerex is still playing the old patch, so those shards would have been perfect, but this time they are a little short.
But thanks to the Observer, what they've got planted down, they understand that Fata is alone here. And they didn't de-ward the Obs. So, Jirax and Ana, yeah, they've revealed themselves, but Fly was keeping himself pretty well secret on the other side. That won't last much longer. He's already bailing out. And AUI is looking for a possibility onto No-Tail. Walks up, rolling boulder forward, MSS. He's only got reactive armor. There's no damage he can give to help kill off No-Tail. And No-Tail will have to burn the salve.
He has to salve and 8 tangos on safe lane Pugna. So... He has plenty of sustain for now to stay against the lanes, gonna buy the magic stick.
I think he also understands the fact that his supports can be busy elsewhere. Yeah. Rolling Boulders coming in once more. AUI really trying to get through Notel. There is, again, no level 2 on MSS. No Timber Chain or no Whirling Death.
And Notel actually has higher movement speed than Timber, even under Orb of Venom, because Pugna's base move speed is 335, and Timber's is 290. So he can't catch up when the roll ends. Good roll again from AUI, though. This time he has to stun. He's going to kill him.
With the kick, Icarus dive. It takes too long from Fly. He didn't actually have sprites to give either. And now MSS will move in closer. This happened also because the pull happened. So there was no way for Notel. Fly is running away from MSS. Whirling Death and one more punch will do the work. And Cloud9 get two kills on their top lane.
That one coming. That's what you can. Oh, and nice steal from AUI as well.
They didn't have an Earth Spirit player, is what we thought.
I mean, he may have played a game or two. I don't remember. It's not a hero I connect with, this player.
Yeah, we always think of techies when it comes to AUI.
I don't think of techies at all.
I think of him every day.
Yep.
I think of that game you had to cast
miserable.
In Frankfurt.
Yeah.
Techies, if you ever want a analyst to cast a fantastic game they feel really simulated with, get them to cast a Techies game. Nice double Light Striker right in the middle from Fada, keeping Ana and Jirax out once again. Yeah, maybe Jirax didn't get the patch note memo. Pushes them away with the Ice Shards once more.
So just to explain how this works, when you use Ice Shards now, where you target it is where the back wall of the shards end up. In the past, where you target it was where the center of the half circle would be that the shards form. So that means you need to cast it further back now if you haven't played Tusk for a while. I'm pretty sure Jirax has played Tusk for a while. I don't think he's just randomly picking it now and he hasn't played it for like 3 patches, but it's kind of funny in some games that you watch, it's just like the Tusk just needs 30 minutes to adapt. Cause you can just tell he hasn't played Tusk for like 2 months. Not in pro games, however, but you know.
I don't think Jirax would have too many problems with that, but it'll be changing a muscle reflex, mate.
Pretty much. It's just you just need to convince your brain that it's wrong for the first part of the game, and then it's like fixed after that. Nice dodge of the stun there by Jirax.
He's creating space more than anything else.
Pretty
he
much,
talked
yeah.
about like the issues for Ana potentially getting ganked. Yeah, the top lane's died. Notel, you can see.
Oh, those were good though. That was really good shards. Counterplay from AUI.
Oh, Boulder! AUI got the double kick onto Ana as well as Jirax. Jirax has a snowball available. Ana trying to get out of this one. The Light Strike Ray will connect. Fada staying right on his tail with the one charges and the course. The slave will be able to reach him just on the tip. Ana will fall down. Fada wants a little bit more, but doesn't have the damage to kill off Jirax.
I'm actually very surprised the CS in the mid is the way it is. Like, even with both Tusk and I guess Tusk started.
Oh, Jirax, no. Wait, hang on. Is he gonna?
He's fine.
Okay. It's because Fada got himself an Invisor, and I thought Jirax was gonna tank and farm a little bit for just a second longer. Fly is getting. Okay, MSS, don't try and attack.
But yeah, this is basically the trade-off we had in the start, was that the Tusk was targeting mid a lot and Earth Spirit was targeting top in the start, so Fata fell behind a little bit on CS because he was getting targeted harder in that sense. But, you know, generally when you watch this matchup, it's the Lina that's ahead over the Invoker. And he is ahead on levels. It looks like the Invoker is doing well here because he's 6 CS up, but Fata almost has a full level advantage here after that kill. And that can very quickly snowball in this mid lane. We're going to roll in with AUI. We'll be dodge.
And this time Ana actually got a little bit of vision thanks to the Yobs ward, but
he's still going
to
die.
Yeah, he's got a couple of one charges up his sleeve and with the cold snap and the ice wall.
Oh, he missed!
Oh, he's going to...
Oh, no!
Oh, the slave is a little bit off to the right!
Ana is so good. I think Fata is a bit triggered now. That is so... Oh, my God. It's like, it's one thing that you miss, but you feel like that attack didn't miss because you know, you fired it and you didn't see the miss text until the attack actually misses.
Oh, AUI. He just tried a rolling boulder away. He'll still get the double kick, however. Jirax and Fly hot in the tails. There goes the Shaz. Now AUI is actually pinned. He cannot get out. He is another block in Jirax's igloo.
Those kind of things, I can't state enough how much it actually matters that this kill mid doesn't happen. If this kill happens and they do it successfully, Earth Spirit might not be moving there. Fata would have been level 6 way earlier, and he used all of his mana to not get the kill. So, like this mid lane now where they're both pretty much level 6 would have been maybe an almost level 7 Lina and a level 5 Invoker. And that is really
they're going
dangerous.
Again.
Now instead there's plays available. Very nice by Jerex.
You want to tilt somebody, this is one way to do it. Snowball forward, Vada able to get the able to get Cole snapped up. Anna with the extra help of Fly. The Light Strike Array is actually going to get him with the Slay. Vada, turn your frown upside down. They'll get both the Fire Rat as well as the Master of Magic.
All right, never mind.
And Envy's going to go for the solo kill on bottom. He can consume Mango and go for the Omni Slash, but decides against it against S4. Okay, he still can. Okay, he consumed the Mango.
So right after OG got that, got out of jail in mid, they go for a three-man gank and die two. So now mid lane is back to what we were expecting it to be. Been chaotic.
Everything in the world is back to where. Wait. S4. Trying to bait with a huge cleaver. It's not like they're going to see your animation. Envy spins and then just backs out.
As far as getting some pretty good farm, this lane is not that easy for the X. Playing against Jugger Lich, not the easiest thing ever. Of course, Envy, miles ahead.
Yeah, all three cores of Cloud9 are miles ahead. They have the top three net worths on the board at the moment. 3-2-3-1 and just shy of 2-7. And the highest you have is Anna. Actually, I take that back. Now it's actually Axe. He's just ahead at 2.5. Notel, rolling boulder forward, gonna miss his target. Jirax is nearby. They shard up again, not able to block MSS, but they interrupt his Timber Chain out. So Notel moves in with more Nether Blast, but the damage isn't enough. The Sunstrike, MSS decides to be aggressive, turns around for the fight. Even AUI unintentionally click kicking Fly in with the rock. So they'll lose the Pugna, and Cloud9 running forward, MSS having to dodge sprites. But I don't think he really cares that much. He's still taking him to survive.
And a sentry mid. This could be a really big kill. He can kill him almost on his own. AUI comes in.
Yeah, rolling boulder into spin.
Oh, they. Whoa. They don't have. He
wait,
didn't have any stones.
Does he go up?
He had no stones left.
They see him. They see him. They see him. He's in the sentry. He's in the sentry. He's out of the sentry.
Close call.
Vision game.
That could have been very different if AUI had one stone, but he has used all of his stones. He's been in so many plays that his stone economy right now needs a bit of time to build up again. If there was a silence there so Invoker couldn't go Ghost Walk or a stun, they could have maybe killed him there, but Ana gets out again.
So is this when we say it's a 2-2? Ana is 2, Cloud9 is 2? And as Mason dodged the gang a couple of times, MSS, nice chain. That snowball's going to go in deep. And the Sunray damage, Jurek doesn't reach him. MSS just chains further and further away. Ochi really wanting the kill on that offlane Timbersaw.
I get it. Now, mid lane pressure will be applied with this rotation of heroes. Actually, wait, how did that happen? S4 just solo killed Lich with Axe. Not exactly the lane I was looking at. This was a very unlikely play, I think.
Just S4 things.
He might have caught him on the way out of the shop, or maybe Pi was just a bit out of position there. It's
Jurex is coming in towards the mid. They're trying to stop Eternal Envy and AUI from just taking the tower, so Jurex will take the creep wave away from the tower, rolling boulder, dodged by Jurex. See it coming from a mile away, and then rolling boulders to the range creep under the tower. Sunray's down, Jurex doesn't have enough life to survive that. AUI trying to help out with a kick, now into the Omni Slash. Anna, the Sunstrike's in a good position. Eternal Envy sharing the burden with his creep wave. But the burden is too much. Envy will die underneath the tier 1 tower. Notel joins the fight, but he doesn't have the mana. Even with the Soul Ring and one charge, there's not enough to give. And Fada has Laguna Blade. Notel knows he has to give that respect.
He could easily get caught by a roll here. Still only one stone now on AUI, but these heroes of OG are very low. And at the same time, there was a kill top, right? Or was that bottom? MSS killed S4, so
yep.
The Timber rotated down and got a very nice kill there, of course.
It looks like he was creep skipping.
Yep. About right.
That's a nice observer ward to have for OG. They now see four heroes from Cloud9 in the mid lane. Like, Phoenix and probably just like Sunray and slow this down. Speaking of yet again another kill in bottom lane that we get to miss, it's Notel solo killing MSS.
There's so much stuff going on in this game that is like all of these solo kills and weird ganks that are happening is very active and very unpredictable.
Well, you're expecting the fight to happen in mid, like Cloud9 to push through to push it, and then Notel just walks down, realizes he's more powerful than the Timber will ever be. And Anna's gonna join him. They want to try and force this, like Fada is nearby. Notel is just so juicy. You want to go for him. And AUI, rolling ball forward, Anna.
Oh, they still don't have dust.
No reveal.
This already happened once before now for UI. Really needs
to
have
dust. Oh, they found another one. No tell. He's decrepifying, but then the Blade Fury is doing more work. Ned the Warden's down. Eternal Envy doesn't have Omni Slash. And right now, oh, the silence. Pugna couldn't drain out of him enough. The Healing Ward will die. MSS will jump in. They can at least farm the Nether Ward.
20 gold. Yeah!
Ah, critical.
Who cares about the Pugna kill if we can get 20 gold for a 3-hero rotation?
I had actually 5 heroes in the bottom part at the end of all of that.
More or less.
OG rotated 2 down for that.
It feels like the game is stabilizing a little bit now with the way heroes are moving around. I think the main thing to keep an eye on right now is the fact that everyone has their ultimate apart from the Tusk. Tusk is a bit far behind here, but the rest of the heroes are definitely able to team fight. So we're probably going to be looking a bit more towards, like, the heroes will come together more now. S4 has his Blink Dagger, and then this Phoenix ulti. This is the time to go, and it looks like that's exactly what they're going to do. So here comes the smoke.
The Dire just scanned, and they got a positive ping on AUI moving up. So either they'll know it's a ward, or they believe they're being swarmed in from around the back. And in fact, that's the line that was drawn in by Fly. He was actually thinking that people were doing the old wraparound.
This kill on No-Till would be very, very good for Cloud9. It's going to give them a tower as well, but No-Till reads it perfectly. Dodges around the long way and gets his tower.
Too many players missing.
Yep.
No one's pressuring the mid anymore. There's a bottom lane that's not taking any level of farm. Like, compared to game one, these lanes have practically been a ghost town. For the amount of people spending time in them, farming them up, everyone's rotating with multiple numbers to take the fights. And OG, they are here. They're here in force. Quick little sigil. MV starts to spin. He may have actually really wanted to have that in a bit, but Georax throws the shards out. They'll be pushed a little bit higher. Pilot Die. He's got that Chain Frost available. Sunray is out. Here comes Pilot Die. Chain Frost up. Icarus Dive can take it up, down, and around. And the Snowball, it never bounces. The Omni Slash, it goes on top of S4. Envy starting off his spin. S4 doesn't have the life to survive through this. Maybe now he does. Able to get the call and the dunk. The bonus move speed. Getting Georax to get away. And the blink from S4 to the trees. The bonuses allow them to escape the Timbersaw and get a 1-for-1 trade-off. They did still lose No-Tail, who was trying to battle the back lines. Georax, okay, maybe not out scot-free. Chipper chain up, Georax, Snowball dodges straight through the middle of the chain. Chakram is back up for MSS. Chains forward, Chakram's down, Georax, Mr. Michael Flatley right now, Lord of the Tusk. Dodging the attacks perfectly.
Very nice footwork by OG, honestly. Both of those plays from Georax and S4 could have easily ended in Cloud9 kills, but got outmaneuvered and outplayed in both occasions, and they also defend their tower this way. OG barely took any damage on that, and they claim their own. No-Tail got that one. Pie, he will be fine.
Okay.
Oh, Sunstrike. Oh, yep.
Oh! Boom! Got him! Это просто нечто! Now rush it.
Mid tower is going to go down. So another rotation here from Cloud9.
I think Anna's looking for the deny. I think he might be also a little concerned about the rock that's in front of him. Snipe. Here comes Tusker. The kick out. Now, well, the call is there from S4. Juggernaut ain't going anywhere apart from potentially down Barter. Nice last strike array, keeping Anna out of the fight. Laguna Blade, S4 limping himself away, holding the belly like indigestion. Back to the dire side of the river. So Juggernaut for Phoenix. A good trade for OG, but they did still, however, lose that mid tower.
Very, very even game right now.
Yeah, a lot closer than game one.
Yeah, it also feels like going the stretch in this game. It's less obvious who has the better late game. Like, Invoker is regarded as one of the absolute best late gamers, but Pugna generally considered a hero that falls off a little bit, and then you look toward Cloud9, Lina scales very well, Timber actually scales very well, even in an offlane position when he has this of a start. MSS is 5-1 with 66 CS. Jugger is a little bit so-so for phases, but he can also be very good late game. So Cloud9 this time, I think, have the tools to win this one if it goes late.
Yeah.
And that means they don't have to feel as stressed to make these moves that they were making in the first game, where OG just counterplayed them very well.
So then it's up to OG to be the aggressors. But that's
well, maybe. It depends. Because I don't think OG just flat out loses late game either. It's just a lot about who gets the jump and Invoker's ability to scale. Both teams can feel comfortable.
No-Tail. The glimmer gets him so close. He's so close to Fada. They sunray, but they didn't see him. Oh, do they? Yep, there we go. There we go. The burn connects. Fada tries to break free. Here comes your sunstrike. AUI, he'll actually share the low, but the Lina goes down to Notel. With a nether ward, she cannot commit anything. It's one of those brutal things for a Lina where you take the damage before the ability is cast. So even if she wants the Laguna, she'll kill herself.
Yeah.
And still not do the damage.
It's a level 1 ward, by the way.
It's only level 1?
It only gets worse.
True.
It only gets worse. Decrepify is a really good spell. It's been buffed a lot of times now. It's pretty crazy how much this ability does now. 6-second cooldown. 3.5-second duration. Makes things die or not die.
Amplify a hero like Timbersaw who can resist almost every bit of physical damage.
Pugna can make Invoker look really good sometimes.
Yeah.
We didn't actually talk very much about how Decrepify synergizes with their lineup for this. It's very good with Phoenix and Invoker. Somewhat decent with
TPing top. S4's coming in. He wants the creep wave, however. He doesn't just want to have MSS by himself, but with Call into Sunstrike, Rolling Boulder, they'll flip him like, oh!
That was really close.
Yeah. Meanwhile, on bottom lane, no tell will die. But that Culling Blade mid-chain. It's like the master of blades.
The top tower did fall
it
there
did.
For OG, so at the very least, MSS managed to accomplish that. His move, and like you said, they got the kill on the Pugna. Still very, very even. I'm curious to see if Cloud9 will be looking to, like, just what pace they're going to go with. Because as I said before, they can play it fast, they can play it slow. I don't feel like there's necessarily a problem to either style. But I wonder what they feel. Like, if it's like, we can't let Invoker free farm. We need to go and get stuff done, or we trust in our abilities to scale. Because, you know, their Lina, for example, is going for a Bloodstone first item, which is generally considered a bit of a slower farming-oriented build-up, rather than going for, say, a Yule's first, where you really just want to fight and find picks all the time. The Juggernaut is going straight into Manta, this time no drum for Envy, so also a bit more maybe far-up.
Courier Snipe! Courier Kick! Had that vitality booster which
kicked
belongs
with the
to Fada.
Fist.
Kicked with the fist. Yeah. Trying to use the Agnims and for to be a real. but it's funny talking about like all these items like going into potential late game, like it's the sand transition for Cloud9. No Tail, I was expecting the Yule Scepter to be coming out on him, like some kind of extra disable or something to amplify him up, but Aether Lens as well as Glimmer Cape, and then going into an Aghanim Scepter is his second one.
This is the... We haven't seen that much Pugna, but I think this is like one of the more standard builds to go for right now. You get the Glimmer for your own defense mainly. Cast range is massively important on Pugna, so I definitely think Lens is almost always going to be a good choice. So you can blast from far away and drain from far away.
Is it worth disassembling him later on as well? Like, you are up against a Timbersaw. I don't know if you've ever thought about building a silver engine, a Pugna. Right now, I don't know who else on OG would buy one.
I mean, it's extremely gimmicky. It could happen, but I don't even think he's thought about that option.
Call, Sunstrike, the Blade Mail is down, and that's exactly what you're talking about. It's the counter to the Juggernaut. When Blade Mail is up, Juggernaut goes down.
Ow.
Woo! There goes the pop with the Lich Ulti. It doesn't bounce anymore, though, but you've still got a 2-for-3 trade-off. Georax will go down, stuck inside the Sharkroom, but now MSS is the one in trouble. Anna sitting in the back lines with all the disable, all the control. But still a 4-for-3 trade-off. No team really coming out fully on top of that one. Maybe OG, just because they're 2 core survived compared to Cloud9, 0 core surviving.
Yeah, they get a lot of nice gold on the Pugna Invoker. That's... If they have to keep two heroes alive, these are the two they want to keep. And in addition, Ana, I think, got 2 or 3 kills as well in this fight. So that's the Sunstrike. I think that's the first kill he gets.
First reveal, the Blade Mail as well.
Yep. Actually, don't even think they need it. Axe together with Invoker deals so much damage with this. Very nice Chain Frost. Huge impact on this fight again. I think Pilot Eye has been very good at using Chain Frost both games so far. But here is kill trade. Ana gets 2, No-Tail gets 2.
I'm still wondering if Cloud9 are very happy with that fight, because it felt like they were struggling for positioning. Like, you had No-Tail controlling up perfectly the high ground, just a little bit to the bottom right of the fight. Like, then you had Ana coming in through the other side, and I think it was Cloud9 were just trying to retreat back to their tier 2 tower and make the best out of it.
It's a difficult position to fight in for the Radiant. It's one of the best avenues of attack for Dire, because they have, like you said, they have multiple ways of coming in, and they have the high ground. all things considered, I think Cloud9 should be okay with this. The Juggernaut died before the fight even began, right? So
yeah,
that was kind of the 4-5 afterwards.
Envy just got very lucky. The creep wave aggro to OG in the trees, and because of that, their gank got revealed.
S4 didn't break his smoke though. Still on the hunt here. Got a very nice position here in the bottom lane. If this team is able to push into this tower, this could set them up very nicely for a fight.
He has to be. I reckon he had to be tossing up if he was going to creep skip then. Would have dragged the creep wave in perfectly and then beat the living crap out of the tier 2 tower. But it's Cloud9 who are all missing on the map at the moment. The Observe Ward scouting both the Lina and the Timber. Now the Lich. Okay, they see everything. And the ES. And they smoked underneath the Dire Observer Ward. S4, which call do you want to go on? They focus over on the Lina. Once again with the Blade Mail, they're able to delete one hero from this fight. How much more is OG able to get into the Nova? Pilei die as well as AUI having real issues getting out of range of the Nova. And S4 too deep. The Lich Aldi will bounce around. It goes down to Pugna. It's back up into Ana and Axe. They're trying to Sunray heal through this. Now Fly ends up tanking it, but they will survive. The Glimmer negating a little bit of the damage. Snowball up into MSS. Durex needs more space to fight out this one. Underneath the cover of the Nether Ward. Now Fly still very low. 44 HP, but 44 is enough to stay alive. MSS cannot find him on the back line. Eternal Envy into the fight too. He's already burned his Omni Slash. S4 looking for the spins on the wave, letting the Blade Mail do the work. Dunk Spider! Just as they kill each other at the very end of it all. Cloud9 are pushing out hard. They want all the OG calls, but Notel sucking them dry for the moment until they'll cut him down with the blades. Pilei die actually frost blasting Notel out.
That was a really long fight. And one of the very surprising things for me in that fight, I'm not sure how much of a replay we're going to get, if we're going to get the whole thing from the start, but... So, it's one thing, like, Cloud9 smoke, and OG know it. Fata was running toward the stairwell, and his smoke broke, and he just ignored it. He ran through another full 2 seconds, just up the hill.
Here's the replay.
So, the smoke is already broken. He just keeps going, man. He's just going in. And now he's dead. I don't know if he wanted to get gone on, because he has Bloodstone, so he's alive very soon, and he's probably one of the better things that can happen, but this Icarus dive from Fly was sick. He actually blocked the rolling boulder out when he was flying in, so they got a bonus kill on the Earth Spirit. If Earth Spirit gets out there, this can get really nasty for OG, because let's be honest, they're diving really deep for this time of the game. This is 22 minutes in. There comes the Omni Clutch again, Fly getting out. Yeah, that's pretty much it for them fighting.
Well, they go and gank up on top.
This is not a replay, guys.
You can see, this is live! As Fly goes down. Cloud9 trying to be really, really aggressive. Got some good wards down as well, but you see OG's Lions drawn directly after that. That's actually coming out from Jirax, I believe. Lions say push mid, push bottom.
Fata's going blink? This is pretty uncommon. I am a really big Blink Dagger fan. I think this item is so good and is still not bought enough in many games, but I don't know...
It's his initiation, the blink Yules.
Yeah, but he doesn't have it.
No, he's got Yules in Quick Buy.
Exactly, but generally you buy them the other way around because the Yules gives you the mana regen and the save for yourself and stuff. It's very good against Axe to have a Yules in your team. You can counter-engage when he goes in for that blink call on the Jugger. It's actually massively important that they get a Yules here that is reliable. So maybe that's why he's getting the blink with it, is that he feels like, okay, I need to always be able to reach Envy and save him from that Axe. But Fata is one of the players who likes to stray away from the norm a little bit and buy other items that he likes. We've seen him in the past, like, revolutionize the ways people played mid. He used to go troll with mech and stuff like that.
Yeah.
Like, he had a patch where mech was the mid item that he really liked. This time, it's not like this is extremely unorthodox to go for a blink, but it was not what I expected.
It's probably him understanding his position. He needs to survive. You look at the difference in Bloodstone charges. Timbersaw's walking around with 17 Bloodstone charges at the moment compared to the 5 Bloodstone charges of Lina. There's just some heroes who just cannot tank and stay alive throughout these fights. MSS is definitely one of them.
And he already has a Yules, and now he's going blink too. So they're going to have two blink Yules in the near future to be able to help Envy, and he needs it this game. The fights have not been easy for this Juggernaut.
OG's gonna miss the gank on him. Envy just left nothing but copies. Ana. Well, EMP burn. MSS's worst friend, but with 30 mana regeneration.
Fata might blink stun here.
Can he get him? Blink. Light Strike Array. Whoa, it's going to connect on the target. Here comes Durax, however. Snowball tries to create space, and it will not work. The silence is on point from AUI. And OG lose two heroes and probably Roshan as well.
Yep. Most definitely a Rosh going the way of Cloud9 here as well. No buybacks.
Let's Fly wants to like kind of mess with him a little bit. S4 is already pressuring top tier 2 tower. It's going to drag MSS out. So right now it's only Envy and Fana inside the pit. I say only. We do have the Night Watchman AUI up on the cliff. This is Cloud9's drop. Okay, so Envy just basically drew a line saying, let's go bottom after this.
Yep. I think they're going to give this one to Fata.
Yeah, they do.
I think it's a good choice. You could argue that getting the Aegis on the Jugger is very good, so that if he gets Blink Blade Mailed by Axe, then he has a second life and can come back. But the way this is more likely to go down now is that if they jump on Envy, they get that Yuul's counterplay and he spins and stays alive. If they jump on Fata, he's just a very quick kill for the other heroes. And he has way more to give in the fight with his second life. Juggernaut will use Omni Slash, and then when that is used, it's like, okay, hope we won. If we didn't, my hero is not that strong afterwards with the items I have. Fata's second life has a lot of value. I like this lots. Tower?
Yep, tier 2 tower is gone. OG. That tier 3 tower looks like it will come under siege
here?
With... Yeah, they're going.
Alright.
You have every ulti up for OG.
This is bold.
And you
this
have...
is really bold.
Okay, Durex is TPing back. Everyone's TPing back. It looks like also OG were not expecting this.
No, they just... they forced the TPs and then they got the hell out of there. Yep. I don't think they can go in there when there's multiple heroes on defense.
Anna's still playing around the mid. He can't come back. He actually had BTs on cooldown. So he just added as much pressure and space to the mid lane. And then instantly invokes Ghostwalk, just in case.
Yep.
But he got himself a double damage rune to invoke a hunt time.
I don't think OG want to make aggressive moves now as anything else than a full unit. It's difficult for them to take skirmishes into this Radiant lineup now that they have all these items plus the Aegis.
Yeah.
They want a structured team fight where they can get Blink, Call, Blademail into Phoenix. The Blink Call plus Sunstrike is not likely to succeed anymore now that there's this Blink Yules.
Maybe what they want to do is just not fight at all. Force this exact situation.
They found an
O-tail. Yeah, but Anna is all... well, okay, yeah, they can fight top lane. I'm sticking down towards bottom lane if they want MSS. The Sunstrike is going to be able to connect with Call Snaps as well. Here comes your Call once more. S4, all they got to do is drop him down low, and then they can Culling Blade him down. So it looked like S4 was just trying to create space. Meanwhile, on top lane, No-Tail is still alive. The sentries are down from both sides. No-Tail makes a break for the tree line. Observer is also planted. The creep wave will take care of that pretty quickly. So Smoke and Mirrors, Snowball, Thorn. He's going for Eternal Envy. It's not even for Pylai Dai. G-Rex doesn't even give a crap about the support. He wants the core. The Nova, they're trying to run out. Envy thought for a moment he could run in, but he made his way towards the Nova. Shards fight forward once more. Here comes your Timbersaw, but he got smacked down by the Nova, and Anaris joined the fight as well. The call is out. S4 held them there. The Sunray, he cannot reach G-Rex, but the burn will hit onto Fada. Second life available thanks to the Aegis the Immortal. Timbersaw drained inside. Insanely low. AUI wants something more. No-Tail on the run back out. All of OG are trying to run out, and No-Tail hides in a crevice. They don't see him. They have no idea. Clueless is the name of this movie.
Cloud9 need detection, man. Like this Glimmer Cape and this Ghost Walk is doing so much, I think.
They tried, they put a sentry ward down the middle of the fight, but the fight progressed so far.
They need a dust, finally. Okay, AUI was like, okay, that's enough, man. That's enough. He had two moments earlier in the early game where they didn't
enough?
Have dust.
Look at tier 3 tower bottom lane. It just got taken. Anna was pushing the lane out. His four spirits finished the job. He moved so fast to get down there. Involved in the fight, switches to bottom lane. Didn't even BT down there, I don't think.
That last fight, I don't know if we can get a replay of it now, but I think 3 kills were avoided because OG had that Glamour Cave and the Ghost Walk. Like, in succession, OG could have been run over there. That was an Aegis fight that OG won. They were fighting into Aegis and got away with it. And the position of that fight and the way spells were used, are we seeing it now?
Or is this, this is now.
He's just glimmering for fun by now. It's like, yeah, I have a Glimmer Cave. Did you guys know? Because you're playing like you don't. Get a dust! Okay.
And that's why Jerex is buying a gem next. Get rid of all the possible sentry wards. Quest, there's no one in Viz that's running. The pilot does have the two dust.
Yeah, this is crucial. I think... Oh, they bought two dusts. Okay, nice. Because I think the Earth Spirit desperately needs a dust in these fights. As I mentioned, very early in the game, he missed like one or two opportunities, and after that, I was expecting to just see dust all the time. You know, sometimes you slip, you forget it, or you don't have the gold in the right moment because you're buying your Blink Dagger or whatever, and then you just don't have a dust. Mm-hmm. But... until this game ends, detection will not be a problem for Cloud9. I think it's like that. By now, they've been screwed by it too many times to not deal with it for the rest of the game.
Could be smart for OG. Jirax puts down two aggressive observer wards on the top lane, allows him to push the tier 1 tower. But more importantly, because of the damage that Ana did on bottom, the fact they took out the tier 3 tower, these shrines are now exposed. So OG can get rid of Cloud9's Roshan Shrine, which is probably more critical than anything else. With no tier 1 tower in the mid, it'll take them a while to bring in reinforcements and ensure they get the next Aegis to the Immortal.
And they have a good amount of time to take the shrine as well, because the Roshan died 5 minutes ago. So there's still like a good couple of minutes to send in some Fort Spirits or some Nether Blasts and then eventually get rid of that shrine. I think it should be next on the menu. It's either that or they try to go for a really aggressive play bottom and get Alina Rax, because that tower being gone is a really big deal for the defense of Cloud9, obviously.
The decent way of pushing in through top, and no one gonna react to it. Alright, I say that now. I see four TPs come to the top lane to react to it.
This could get... Do OG want to fight this? Looks like they do. This is going to be a full-on 5-on-5 if OG go in right now. Envy can very quickly connect. He's going to run through a ward, though.
Oh, there's your taunt. It's over on MSS. Sunstrike's kicking in. Jirax in the neighborhood. AUI. The snowball dodges the kick that came from him. S4 had the BKB to protect himself anyway. But the EMP splits the field up. OG, maybe not so certain about going back in just yet. Blade mails off cooldown in 1 second, but the BKB won't be available this time. And Ana... well, he was starting his BT out and blinks away, realizing the Fada was going to go for the stun. And they realized it too. They know he had the vision. They pinged the ward out straight away.
Oh, this is classic Light of Heaven. He always pings the shrines. I don't know why. He's pinging the shrine all the time.
They found a target. Blink, Morris punch. The Sunstrike actually connects on AUI, or his Fada, but the Lacuna Blade Invoker is deleted. The Yule set to follow up Tuskar. Basically shook around, but no! The shards! Jirax understands that positioning, push himself down the hill, trying to dodge the Light Strike Array, but that's just too much to dodge. Four heroes around him, and that is a big pickup for Cloud9. Invoker down, it's good gold, it's good experience.
That was a very optimistic attempt, I think, from OG. So
top
they have...
dead.
Yep.
Hi, Envy. Oh, wait, wait, oh. Wait. Yeah.
Didn't even have Mana for calling Blade, he just gets...
Fada's coming in, Pilot A, they get the Frost, Fly. He's stuck in the tree line, starts his TP, they need a stun, Fada. Too late. And you'll also get S4 back out to safety. Meanwhile, No-Tail taking a shrine.
Yep.
Light of Heaven, please ping.
Ping it. Okay, so the... I think the reason Ana and Jirax went for that attempt they did before where they both died was that they have really good vision in the area. You see these this aggressive Dire Observer ward there. But they were so close to the tower, and if that kill doesn't happen instantly and they have a get out plan afterward, then it's going to cost you. And they didn't even get a kill. But ultimately, of course, this kill on the Juggernaut is going to help buy OG time to get their cores back in the game, and it doesn't cost them too much at the end. Stabilizing again, 3k lead for OG. Roche is spawning soon, and the top shrine did not get claimed, so Cloud9 still has that strategic element to play around. And now there's a gem on AUI as well. Dust isn't even enough, guys. Now they got the full package. Gem, dust, sentries.
It's a shame he couldn't have waited longer and just stole it. Jirax is going to buy one.
Yep. So Jirax is going to carry the gem for OG, and the gem for the Radiant on Cloud9 is on Pilot Eye, actually. He gave it away with Earth Spirit, because I think he's expecting, I'm going to roll in, I'm going to die.
Sacrificial Spirit.
Yep, pretty much.
You got BTs on Fada, so he can join this top fight when he's ready.
Yep.
And both teams are lining themselves up for it, and yeah, there's the TP already.
Tinker Ward from OG.
Roshan's up. The sigil goes inside the pit. It didn't go in deep enough to look at Roshan. But the Forged Spirits are on a scouting mission. They're going to come in around the back of the smoked up Cloud 9. Tinker Ward doesn't see enough. The line's being drawn now by AUI. Beeline to the tier 2 tower in mid. And that's actually the best place to attack. OG, I'd say they're not in position to defend from this. They have the low ground. So at least it'll be even ground if Cloud9 come down to them.
This is a very big moment. And nobody finds anything. So OG dodged their smoke. And OG have their own. They're going to smoke themselves, I think, after this camp.
It's like that cliffhanger at the end of season one. Don't worry, we'll come back for season two at the end of the next smoke.
OG aren't even checking them.
Yeah, they were literally in front of it. And they didn't have a look. The Forge Spirits should actually go in now. Yeah, the ping just came out from Flyers. Like, just put the Forge, just send one in. Like, oh, there he is.
They got rid of the top shrine, so Cloud9 don't have that to play around any longer. Cloud9's smoke failing there is pretty important because OG, as mentioned, still have their own. What's the timing on these peak? 9 seconds on TV for Axe, and Lina is the only other one, right? 2 9-seconds.
And you've got a 10-second BKB on the way for Invoker. He's already finished up his Axe and Octarine.
Oh, yeah. Okay,
BKB and then into Shiva's appears to be the build order for Rat.
BKB is an amazing item for both teams this game, so it's worth keeping an eye on the status of that.
Is that actually the full Shiva's?
Fata never got his Yules, by the way.
He didn't finish it?
He just went for that BKB. So they only have the Yules of Timber still.
Maybe they're happy with that. Like Timber Yules is enough to at least try and save Envy. It's like, apart from that Envy, at least do it yourself. He's got Manta, he's got Blink Dagger, he's got Spin.
Very, very underfarmed. The big farmers this game are the Lina and the Timber. You can see the CS here. This is not... Oh. Jugger is difficult to play in this position because this hero... I mean, it's just how the game plays out. They need to push the waves, and Jugger is just worse at it than the other two heroes, so they will get more farm. But it's hard to play Jugger like this. He's very underfarmed compared to the other cores, and the hero itself is just not that good.
That's why Nimbus rune. If he actually felt confident enough to move up the hill, he probably would have died, thanks to the Observer and Sentry again down for Cloud9. It appears every time they want to take a fight around Roshan, like this Obs as well as like sort of Sentry Ward get planted just in front of the pit. Almost every time. It's that same kind of position every time. Mm-hmm. I'd say every time in two games. Worth of like four sets of wards.
Very important place to cover.
Yep. Just makes it obvious for S4 to dodge.
I wonder if Timber is going to reach a stage here where he won't die, even if he gets jumped on by X plus full Invoker combo and everything, because MSS is getting really tanky. Hood Octarine, he has 3k health, he's close to 25 now.
Yeah, maybe it would have been better for like a Bloodthorn style build coming in from the Invoker.
Could have actually been an interesting choice, yeah. I think this physical thing could come back to haunt them still.
MSS! Okay, maybe he knows he's that tanky.
Oh, that's a good nether ward placement. Need to get rid of that.
Very difficult. They have to cut the trees to see it.
I don't really want to.
He's really not certain about it. Because he knows if he jumps in that far, potentially Axe can just blink, call him, and then they Sunstrike and just combo. Forcing the rest of Cloud9 to fight underneath the nether ward. Alright, so it's got to be Roshan for somebody. It's like no one wants to take the risk. Okay, that might help. S4 found himself a haste rune. Quick nether ward down for Notel. Stars his TP out. This is problematic. Notel, do they just cut their losses? No, he's got Glimmer Cape. There are no losses.
None of the reveals were nearby. Both the Lich and the Earth Spirit were far away, so he gets out of that.
And Anna's also not involved. He can't be. His BTs are still on cooldown for 10 more seconds.
Yep.
He was busy farming up, but what's coming on the courier? His BKB is now done. Now they actually want to fight. The fresh 10-second BKB in the 2 9-seconds. That's a lot of immunity for Cloud9 to try and play around.
And the farmed heroes on Cloud9's side are not the Jugger, so that means this BKB for Ana is just as efficient as the other one we talked about. It's going to be impossible to kill almost. All right, here we go.
Up Tornado, EMP, yep. All he wants to do is just to lay up MSS. MSS gonna Yule Scepter out of the effect of at least the EMP as they push him down, but S4, the perfect call. They dunk down the Timbersaw. Unkillable, I think not. And now they go for more. The quick tornado, it caught Eternal Envy. You said his life was hard. He'll spin, get punched, flip like an omelet from Tusker. They want more. Omni Slash. Tusker needs some help. S4 will tank it, turns on the Blade Mail, starts the spins up, and Eternal Envy so low. S4 getting the breath of life from Notail. The Sunstrike's right in the mark. Two Pilot Eye will fall. Anna has himself a double kill under the protection of his BKB. Sands his ground. He'll look for the gem. MSS will have to gather it up. But here they go, Tusker, snowball forward. Anna does have that gem of true sight stolen from Cloud9, so he knows he got the vision win. Not to mention the team fight win. The score might be leveled at 25-25, but OG are in a commanding position now.
Yeah, that was a really good kill on the Timber. And I mean, of course, if it's like a 3-on-1 for a good 10 or 15 seconds, then the Timber is gonna die. And his team didn't really find any good way of connecting there. They got one defensive 4-step off, but didn't really manage to save him, and then when he buys back and comes back in, they find themselves in these awkward positions, and No-Tail was, for me, just saving that fight time and time again. Really, really good life drains, healing up S4. I think he healed him up twice and saved him, and we might be seeing it again here. So here comes the Tornado EMP. Jugger has to spin this, so now spin is on cooldown. Let's get off a pretty good Omni here. That stone kick is far off the mark.
And then S4 tanks it. The life gets given right here. He gets in just in range.
Fata is trying to destroy the supernova, and he doesn't manage either. If Fata wanted, he could have just killed the axe there. He could have just gone in and lagooned at him, but he thought the team had control of that and that he could kill the supernova. And these small things add up and make a really big fight for OG, where slightly different decision-making from Cloud9 would have maybe made that somewhat even.
And now OG's lead really stretches forward. They're approaching 15,000 net worth in front, and experience has already reached that mark. They are just light years ahead. They've taken almost... Well, they've still got two tier 2 towers left to go down. Been very focused on just ensuring the fights win out. And it's making the supports of Cloud9 almost useless. Speaking of which, like, the lowest net worth here on the field, Pileidai, dies to Anna. They snowball forward. They're looking towards Fata. The shards don't block him in. Instead, Anna actually blinks himself a little bit further away. G-Rex wants to keep going. Looking towards MSS, S4 was not there in time. His blink was on cooldown at the time. Couldn't reach to get the call off. But they'll take the tier 2 tower now.
I think it's high ground time now for OG. They have Aegis. They have the BKB on Anna, the heart on S4. There's just so much tankiness now, and the Jugger is tickling them still. So.
Yep.
Should be able to go in. Anna will do this fairly quickly as well. So very farmed Invoker, Nether Blast helping out from the back. Cloud9 gotta do something.
AUI is trying to play silly from the tree line. Gets a silence on Anna, but it won't matter. No-Tail wants to take the damage. He wanted to actually expend his cheese and keep Anna alive. Anna's still got the Aegis. Blink dodges Sharkroom. Tornado spam his heart out. Negative 18 second cooldown on that one. And then Nether Blast, Nether Blast, Nether Blast. And they're searching for AUI. Snowball. AUI is going to drag G-Rex in pretty far. In fact, G-Rex is in way too deep. They'll kill him off and maybe get that gem back.
Glimmer Cape, no, not again.
Glimmer Cape, the Sunray, and the drain from No-Tail. G-Rex is back to full life. They're sustained. Right now, it's Team Fortress 2 Medic. You'll go into the Omni Slash. S4 calls, tanks it himself, realizing his armor. Envy hits like kittens at the moment. He's forced back into his home, but they've already lost a large portion of that home. This is clinical from OG. Literally, medical. Who needs a dazzle? You don't need a dazzle in this game anymore. Just run a one position Pugna that's able to make Anna the be all end all of Alakazam.
S4. Oh!
He was looking for it. Almost got AUI. This Timbersaw. He can't even chain away. The Tornado, at least his Yule Scepter will protect him from that. The Sunstrike somehow manages to hit the eye of the Cloud9 Fall Hero Needle. Oh, confidence from Envy. Ball from S4, ineffective.
The problem is for Cloud9 that they're not accomplishing anything. They're just losing towers.
Yep.
There we go.
Here we go. They get one, but the snowball, S4! He's got the call on the back line, starts to spin. The Sunstrike will connect on the mark. AUI will fall. There's your Culling Blade. Bonus damage for every, or movement for everyone. And at least Pylite dies. Ulti has done some work. Tuskar will fall. The Gem of True Sight's on the ground. Anna's completely bone dry of mana. But then again, No Tail is wetting his lips on Pylite dies. Something. Call. Lena. Trapped once more. Drained once more. S4 doesn't have his Culling Blade available. Will dodge the stun from Fada. The man who cannot dodge it is MSS. Running outside the bait as far away as possible. Do they keep the chase going? It looks like Pugna wants to. Sees the TP and then realizes they come back. But they've already taken the top. They've already taken the mid. And there's the Aegis Immortal. Burnt. Anna now has himself a full size device, already replacing the slot. And Fada piglet it up. S4 will get the call. Perfect chain control. And GG is done. OG had a brilliant one in their group stage at TI6. And they're off to a pretty good start with this 2-0 victory over Cloud9.
Yep, there's still some of those classic OG moments in this game, I think. When OG go far in tournaments or even win them, I think the two most deciding factors are that they're very good at understanding when and how to fight, and they set up good conditions to take the fights under. And the other thing is they just have this clutchness in their support duo, very good at playing save style, at making very quick reactions and quick moves. In this game, I think the Tusk and Axe both counterplayed very well. We saw some great plays. Actually, out of the entire team, all five players made counterplays this game at a very quick pace. So, if OG is playing like this, they look strong. I'm still not completely sold on the two drafts they had today, but their plays with what they had were very good. And then we're gonna have to see when they meet opponents later on today and tomorrow if they can keep up the pace.
Yeah, it's a good confidence start for them, and of course they do take a 2-0 victory now, and they'll move through. We'll be back for more content. Secret versus Infamous will be our next cast here on the main stream, so we'll see you for that.